Life as an actor can bring fame and unimaginable riches, but the truth is many actors in Hollywood are busy waiting tables, waiting for their big break. So you can imagine the delight of our next guest to be working on a show which consistently tops the ratings and has made her a household name around the world.
It is a television phenomenon which is fast approaching its 20th anniversary. It is screened to an international audience of almost 50 million viewers each day. If our next guest wasn't a member of the cast, they would have dropped the word beautiful from the title. From the Bold and the Beautiful, it's a great pleasure to welcome Susan Flannery. Good morning, Susan.
Good morning, Susan.
Good morning, and delighted to be here.
He's nice a shameless crawler, guys. Though, David, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Susan, it is a phenomenon, the Bold and the Beautiful. Am I right in saying that you record 250 episodes a year?
Yes, we do. We're on 52 weeks out of the year and we do about 250 shows a year. I know.
The workload in that alone must be extraordinary.
No, it's not. Don't let anybody tell you that it is. We have the easy life. The workload is for the people backstage and the writers. The actors have it easy, believe me.
Really? How do you manage to do that many shows, though? I mean, that to me sounds extraordinary.
Well, most of us don't do... I'd say we average, like Catherine Kelly Lang, who plays Brooke, and I, we do about 200 shows a year. And that's out of... So we're not there every single day.
Right, right. There's just quickly on the acting side of things, there are up to 5 plots interwoven on any one episode at any one time. How does that affect the logistics of acting?
Well, it depends on if you are one of the people, like my character is, that interweaves in different stories, then it can get a little complicated sometimes.
How do they manage to keep coming up with storylines? Because some of them become so bizarre over the years.
And
I've watched a bit over the years, and I'm keen to know whether they've ever knocked back a storyline as being too bizarre.
Too far flung, yes.
I mean, have they ever thought a story went to... We've thought the stories have gone too far. The writers love it. They don't think they've gone too far.
So, but have they ever knocked back an idea?
Yes, they have, actually. I've started into a couple of stories, and then all of a sudden the writer will say, oh, I think this isn't right, and he'll step way back at all. And people, they'll call in or they'll write and they'll say, wait a minute, what happened? We were headed in this direction, and now, you know, you're not even going that way.
Do you have much say in the script as such?
No, I've never believed that as an actor I have a right to go in and tell them what kind of stories to write. No, I respect, you know, writing is a mystery. It's one of the creative arts, and to stare and look at that blank page, it takes a lot of courage and a lot of imagination to come up with great stories.
What about therefore as a director? Because I know you've worked as a director. You've directed some episodes of The Bold and the Beautiful as well.
Oh, absolutely, yes. So that's different.
That's much different, isn't it?
Yes, it is. You come in at a totally different perspective on what to do, and that's fun. And you can say to them, gosh, I think we've got to change this and that.
What's it like directing your colleagues on the show that you're also in? What's it like directing yourself?
I don't direct myself. The shows that I direct, I'm not in. But directing the actors on the show, it's fun. Most of them trust me because they've been in scenes with me and worked with me. So if I say to them, you know, before I started directing, we'd be filming and I'd stop the scene and I'd look at them and I'd say, you don't really want to say that way, do you?
Because
and
I was,
they go, oh, okay, all right.
Because I can imagine, and we know it is a really, really tight group. I mean, we hear all the time about this incredibly great connectivity there is with the cast. But does that change, though, when you then tell them what to do?
No, actually, no. They're afraid of me. No, I'm teasing. No, it's actually very nice. I think it's just a lot of trust and respect for we have for one another. We've, you know, the four of us have been there from day one. Catherine, Kelly Lang, Ron Moss, John McCook, and myself. And this is so boring, but in 21 years, we've never had a crossword between us.
Wow.
That's extraordinary.
I know.
You know that.
I know it is.
It's a hell of a responsibility too, because there are audiences around the world that have been with you since day one. So if ever you were to face the decision, I might leave, it must be very difficult because you have that responsibility to that audience, don't you?
I guess in a way you're right. Yes, you're absolutely right. I hadn't thought of it in those terms because I'd like to leave.
But in another
year or so. But now that you've posed this for me, I might have to really think that through.
Are you honest about that? Have you thought about leaving?
Yeah, you know, yes, I'm sure, you know, you're in the grave a long time, and it's nice to be able to do other things, so I'm seriously considering
that. And what would you do? You would leave to do what?
I think travel more, travel, and, yeah.
Do you still fly? I read...
No, I don't fly anymore. You know, that's something that you really have to do, as any pilot will tell you, on an almost daily basis. Because those are skills that you have to really keep honed.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I took up sailing, and that's fun.
Sailing? What's on a boat?
And you have great sailing down here, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
In the Sydney Harbour. I might have to come down and do that sometime.
We do. You need to come down and see the Sydney to Hobart yacht race. It's one of the big ones in the world, one of the most dangerous, too, at times.
Yes, I know.
So I'm really interested to know your travel plans. Where do you want to go? What is it about travelling and what places excite you?
Well, I want to take my daughter on safari, I would love to have gone to Kenya this year, but things have gotten in such a terrible state of turmoil for those people. I don't think that we'll be able to do that. But that's my next stop, so I'll have to figure out where to go, South Africa or...
Absolutely.
There's beautiful game parks in South Africa, and Botswana is fantastic too, the Okavango Delta, go and do that.
Have you been there?
Yes. And
was it fabulous?
It's absolutely fabulous.
Blows your mind, doesn't it? It does. It absolutely blows your mind.
I'm glad you told me.
Zimbabwe is fantastic too. There you go. You got a few.
Give us a call, Susan. We'll map out your travel plans. You mentioned your daughter. Your daughter is actually in Australia studying at university at the moment, isn't she?
She starts at the university this coming week. At Macquarie University. She's been living here for 2 years, and I think this is it. She's fallen madly in love and with a very nice guy who writes all the cricket stuff for this Sydney Herald.
Oh, really?
David Segal, I know.
There you go. Did they meet?
I know. I said to her, he's a great guy, but couldn't it have been Minneapolis or Chicago? Yes. I mean...
and a game you can understand.
Yes. Or Zimbabwe.
Yes. And a game I could understand, yes.
I love it. Look, so in terms of Hollywood and the actor's strike, I mean, obviously it's created the writer's strike, yes. It's created a huge hole. How has that affected you?
It didn't affect us at all. We had scripts way ahead. That's something when you do a show like this, it's easily planned and taken care of. But it's an interesting, it was a very interesting strike, and I hope they're satisfied with what they got. Because, you know, it's a big watershed sort of thing, the internet and all of the content and how it's going to be handled by the studios and by the networks.
It was a bomb waiting to go off.
And it's going to affect everybody, you know, all of entertainment.
I was going to say,
in every country.
The actors now, unless it's already written into an actor's contract, the actors would be looking at that as well, wouldn't they?
Oh, yes. The Screen Actors Guild and the AFTRA, which is our union, this is a big deal. There might be another strike. We don't know.
Are there enough meaty roles for women over 35 in Hollywood?
No. 40 is the deadline.
Why is there such a dark afterwards?
Well, say that again.
Why is there such a hole afterwards?
I think it has to do with the culture and that it's so youth-oriented. And it's something it's hopefully changing slowly, but at least changing, making some inroads to that. But it's a very cultural thing as far as, you know, youth. Mm. And when you hit 40, especially for women, it's goodbye Tootsie.
Yeah, feels a bit like that in this country too.
I think that's just something in the Western culture. Mm. Yeah.
Well, it hasn't been goodbye Tootsie for you. You've had a long...
I know, I was so lucky, wasn't I? Mm.
Has acting been, as a career, has it been everything that you had hoped it would be?
Acting's been very, very good to me. Yes, it's everything that I had hoped it would be. I have to say, I feel so fortunate that, as you know, as a child, as a young person, that you dream that you want to do something, then you get to do it with your life, and you get to really enjoy it.
Yeah.
That's I've been very lucky that
yeah,
way.
Yeah. The other big thing, speaking moving from the writers' strike, the other big thing that's been happening in America, of course, is the race for the presidential candidates. And
I know that
you have political interest. It must be a very exciting time in the States at the moment.
It is absolutely. I think it's a seismic plate change that's happened, and this is one of those moments where history is. Sort of galloping along and overtaking events and overtaking what's that people aren't even realizing how fast it's going. And I think it's going to be very interesting whether it's Mrs. Clinton or Barack Obama. How it's going to play out is going to be very interesting.
Who's your tip?
What's mine? Well, I'm an old feminist, so I voted for Hillary. But I like him very much. I think has a great gift of oratory, and he has a freshness. He's inspired a lot of people, and that's what I mean by a seismic plate shift.
Mm. Yeah.
Had he not been on the scene or just running, I think Hillary Clinton would have been the nominee. It's going to be interesting either one of them runs against McCain, because McCain he's too old. And when I say he's too old, it's not a question of physical age, it's a question of a generation.
Yes.
He just doesn't get it. He just doesn't understand, you know, what the Bush administration, how they've placed my country, in such a terrible state with the rest of the world.
So is it a Democratic victory for sure, do you think?
Well, the Democrats have been known to throw things away. I hope not. I hope it is, yes. I hope we can take the country in a new direction. Something that's good for everybody, not just for us as in our country, but for the rest of the world, to face up to the responsibilities we have in a positive way instead of such a terribly negative and sort of hateful way that somehow has been established.
We've been fascinated in this country by the celebrity endorsement of candidates and the celebrity profile of candidates and of governors and previous presidents.
You mean like Schwarzenegger?
Like Schwarzenegger. Now, hasn't his rise been interesting? And I think I was in the States when he was running for governor of California, and there was a real mood, an anti-Schwarzenegger mood. And then he's in, and that seems to have shifted.
I know. He's very popular with the citizens of the state. He learned his lesson very quickly. I mean, he came in with the idea that he could fix everything, and he sort of went around and went to the people directly with a vote, and the people slapped him back down, and he stood up and he said, I get it, and he has.
Yeah. Mm.
And he's a very clever guy, and he's married to an extremely intelligent woman.
And goodness.
And of Naturally Shriver, you know, from the Kennedy family.
Yeah.
Very, very well versed in politics.
And goodness, wouldn't they have some interesting dinner table conversations on opposite sides of the political wall?
Yeah. Wouldn't you like to listen in on that?
Oh, yes.
Just before we go, Susan, I know that you have a reputation as a gourmet cook. Do you still have the pizza oven out the back?
I do. I have the pizza oven right in the kitchen.
Do
absolutely.
You?
I absolutely do. I love it. It's a great way to entertain. People just, you know, get to make their own pizzas, and it's fun. It's just great.
Do you cook on a stone?
No, it's just a whole natural, it's a real pizza oven. It's all wood. It takes me about three and a half hours to get the temperature up and have to all feed it. It's not gas. It's just an old-fashioned pizza oven.
How fantastic.
Yeah, that sounds great. Yeah.
I'll tell you how, you want me to, do you have enough time? I'll tell you how that happened.
Yeah.
We were filming in Lake Como. And one of the fellows that was on the show came to me and said, Susan, my friends, Mr. and Mrs. Hines of the Hines Ketchup people, have a villa here, and they'd like to have us come over. If you say yes, then the rest of the cast will go. So we went over, and they had a pizza party. And I thought to myself, what a great way to have parties, you know?
Yeah.
They had a woman, a chef, and you got to choose all your own things. George Clooney then bought it. That's his house now.
Oh, nice.
Oh, how funny.
So that's the tippets.
That is
That's
a good
the bits
story.
Of gossip.
Look,
okay.
Susan, it's lovely to talk to you, and hopefully you'll enjoy some quality mother and daughter time while you're in Sydney.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Kim. It was great to visit with both of you.
Thank you for your time, and try and get on an 18-foot skiff on the Sydney Harbour. It's a great way to sail.
Oh, boy, I absolutely will when I come back down.
Thank
Cheers.
You, Susan.
Bye-bye. Bye,
and, of course,
thanks.
The Bold and the Beautiful is on 10 Mondays to Fridays at 4:30 p.m.
Everybody knows that.